Dear panelists and attendees, welcome tonight to another pearl from the mega online anesthesiology course. Before we start, I just would like to express my deepest gratitude to Dr. Saad Mahdi and his team for the great effort behind this outstanding course. It's always an honor for me to take part in this distinguished course. Tonight, we have an exceptional topic which can be a nightmare at some point to the anesthetist, which is the difficult airway management. Tonight, we have five international eminent figures. On the speaker's side, we've got Professor Nisreen Rifai, Professor John Doyle, and Dr. Yasser Zaghloul. On the moderator's side, please allow me to introduce and welcome Dr. Patricia Yazbeck and Dr. Ross Hoffmeyer. Dr. Patricia Yazbeck is a professor in the Department of Anesthesia and Critical Care at Hotel Dieu Medical Center, Saint Joseph University, Beirut, Lebanon. She's also the president of the Lebanese Society of Critical Care Medicine, president of the Pan-Arab Federation of Societies of Anesthesiology, Critical Care and Pain Management. Dr. Ross Hoffmeyer is the associate professor and airway lead, Department of Anesthesia and Perioperative Medicine, University of Cape Town and Groote Hospital, Cape Town, South Africa. He's also the director of the UCT Stores African Fellowship in Airway and Thoracic Anesthesia. Professor Patricia, Dr. Ross, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I'm very pleased to present our third panelist, Dr. Yasser Zaghloul, who is a consultant in anesthesiology and critical care medicine at Sheikh Khalifa Medical City at Abu Dhabi in United Arab Emirates. Dr. Yasser Zaghloul will talk about extubation. Is it hard to do? Thank you, Dr. Zaghloul.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Patricia. Of course, we enjoyed the last two lectures by Professor John and Professor Nasreen. And I think most of the attendants asking what you will tell us after that. Yeah, we are extubating the patient every day. So what you will tell us? And why the term it is hard to do, I will tell you at the end of the lectures. Now, the perioperative management of the airway include five stages: preoperative assessment, induction intubation, intraoperative care, especially in patients with sharing airway, extubation and recovery, postoperative or post-anesthesia care unit. So the first two lectures cover the first 2 points. So still we have 3 points, three, four, and five. We should discuss this issue. So successful airway management doesn't end with the tracheal intubation. It is any more than a safe flight is concerned only with takeoff. If you are not looking after the extubation, your landing will be like that, like this one. Okay, so you have takeoff and landing, intubation and extubations. So the outline of this lecture, some introduction, what is the possible post-extubation complications, unplanned extubation, planning for extubation at the end of the surgery and the conclusion. So extubation is always an elective process. You are not in rush or you're not in hurry to extubate your patient. You should optimize the patient and you have adequate time to manage the patient before the extubation. And it is a risky phase process, either at the end of the anesthesia or in ICU after long-term ventilations. And it was found that the complications after extubation is 3 times more common than intubation. That's why you are always taking all your care to intubate the patient and less care and less attention at the end of the surgery to extubate the patient. And the majority of problems is minor, we are lucky for that. But if a harm complications happen, it may cause permanent brain death and even cardiac arrest and death. And we have a lot of problems which can happen at the end of the surgery, respiratory problems and cardiovascular problem. Stridor, spasm, patient may vomit and aspirate, the patient may develop negative pressure pulmonary edema, and we will have some discussion about this point. VQ mismatching, some atelectasis may happen. Patient may suffer from sore throat and shivering. From the manipulation of airway, we may have periglottic edema and mucociliary dysfunction, especially in smoker patients. At the same time, you have cardiovascular changes, tachycardia, hypertension, 10 to 30% from the baseline. Few patients may develop arrhythmia. Patient may have left ventricular strain from the hypertension and tachycardia. And this is significant in patients with coronary artery disease. There is some records about the ejection fraction may decreased by 50%. If the ejection fraction of the patient is 40% before coming for the surgery, during extubation, it may come down to 25 or 20%. That's why you should be careful. And in ICU, there is a lot of report of failure of extubation and weaning because of myocardial ischemia and infarction during the extubation. So why the extubation may have this all risk? Actually, because the reflexes may take some time, even some hours, to return to the normal after removing the endotracheal tube. And this, of course, will compromise the cuff reflex and the gag reflex, especially if the patient is sleeping. So the patient difficult to sleep, difficult to swallow, and he may develop stridor as well. And actually, the reflex is variable. It may be exaggerated, reduced, or dysfunctions. And it was found that 1/3 of the pulmonary aspirations occurs after extubations. And of course, patient with reactive airway, like patient with bronchial asthma, or the patient at risk of vomiting and aspiration has a higher risk. Here, this is interested report by American Society of the Anesthesiologists regarding the closed claim analysis in two periods of time, from 1993 to 1999 and from 2000 to 2010. And as I mentioned early, the phases of anesthesia divided to 5 stages: pre-induction, induction, intraoperative, extubation, and recovery. And they found that some patients may have brain death or even death during the extubation. The interesting point is that even if 12 claims come, 10% develop brain death or death. 83% is very high. And even the second period of time, this from 2000 to 2010, 13 patients developed some problems, 12 of them has brain death or death. 92% of the patients who developed the harm airway problem die or brain death at the end of surgery. Recovery is considered a big extubation care. And you can find the 3 patients who developed the problem in the recovery room, all of them die. That's why the complications is more serious during the extubation. 92% of the percent brainstem or brain death and 100% in recovery room. Also, we have very interested report from UK about the major complication of airway, either in OR or in ICU, which was published in 2011. And I summarized it in 6 points. Again, 1/3 of the complications happened during recovery. And the laryngeal spasm is an important and leading cause of airway problem, especially in pediatric patients. Bleeding into airway may happen either from the surgery or traumatic airway management during difficult intubation. Laryngeal edema is frequent as well, especially if the patient has airway trauma or the patient in head down position during surgery. The pre-operative risk factors: obese patient, especially patient with obstructive sleep apnea, patient with bronchial asthma, and patient with COPD. This is most commonly to develop problems in recovery room. Another important point, the necessary equipment is not always available. Thus, even if you detect the problem, you can't manage it. So one of the important issues, all the equipment you used during intubation of the patient, either difficult or not difficult, should be standby till the end of the surgery and extubation. And the recommendations from the NP4 report, all the patients should be assisted well and optimized before extubation, and you should have a specific extubation and re-intubation plan. And of course, this is more important in patients with difficult airway. and extubation is usually in theater. Few anesthesiologists may push the patient to the recovery room with the tube in. Actually, it is okay, but it is not safe practice. So according to the P4, most of the patients should be extubated in the theater. Of course, COVID-19 is a big problem, and here this is the extubation of COVID patient and the respiratory distress which may occur after extubation, and it is divided according to the surgery which may happen, patient with cardiopulmonary problem and the patient with upper airway obstruction. It is almost the same like any patient with COVID or without COVID, but the author summarized it in these articles, all either surgery due to the patient or due to the anesthesia. So in summary, for this introduction, extubation now appears to be more dangerous than intubation. That's why we are talking about extubation today. Actually, 8 or 9 years ago, this 2012, it is the year of extubation. All the societies talks about the extubations. The first from DAS, this difficult airway society, published its guidelines for tracheal extubation. And this was associated with editorial letter, and he commented that the extubation is an important but neglected topic. So that's why DAS gave us the DAS guidelines. Also, there is another article about making the unpredictable safer. That means the extubation should be safe than before. And in the American Society of the Anesthesiologists annual meeting, also there is an interested topic about the patient with child and difficult airway. Extubation in pediatric patient with difficult airway is a risk of airway obstruction, so we should be more careful in these patients. And the guidelines by DAS was modified by some physician from the emergency room to adapt these guidelines for ER. If the patient is intubated and extubated ER, this Dr. Mike changed it to match the guidelines already implanted by DAS. This extended to 2013 as well. This, as mentioned by the Professor Nisreen, the difficult airway, they put another extubation and difficult airway extubation failure, and they discussed all the causes and how to manage. And the guidelines by American Society of the Anesthesiologists added a special paragraph about the extubation, that you should have reformulated strategies for extubation, and this depends on the type of surgery and the condition of the patient, skills, and the preference of the anesthesiologist. Some anesthesiologists may do awake extubation or deep extubation. So in short, you can find all the societies focus in the problem in the extubation. Also, this airway management textbook by Karine Hegberg, it is almost the Bible of the airway management. The including a special chapter about the extubation and re-intubation, especially in patients with difficult airway. We have another big problem, unplanned extubation. Maybe it is a major problem in the ICU, but it still can happen in OR as well. And it is a common costly complications of the airway. That's why they found in United States around 120,000 patients has accidental or unplanned extubation every year. And this cost $5 billion. It's very high cost actually. And again, this in ICU and in OR, not in OR only. And because the importance of this unplanned or accidental extubation, around 21 societies in the United States make a collision for unexpected or unplanned extubation awareness and preventions. And to teach all, either this is anesthesiologist, critical care physician, respiratory therapist, nurses, anybody included in the airway management involved in these collisions, 21 societies. This to increase the awareness about the risk of unplanned extubation, to put some strategy and to reduce the incidence, and the most important, the re-intubation plan for all the patients who may have difficult airway or even not difficult airway. Again, this is maybe more important in ICU after long-term ventilation. The majority of the studies I mentioned already in ICU, they found the incidence of unplanned extubation from 0.5 to 35% in adults and up to 80% in neonates. It's very strange. Actually, because the neonate is any minor change in the head and the neck position may pull the tube outside. And in United States, as I mentioned before, the unplanned extubation in ICU, 7.8%. And in neonate, it is 18.2%. Now, Dr. Loreen, it looks the female anesthesiologist more pioneers in the airway management. Anyway, she published this article about the unplanned or accidental extubation in the perioperative environment, but most of the talk again about in the patient in ICU. So what is the risk factors? Risk factors, the most important, you are not securing the tube well. If the patient in ICU, the sedation is not adequate, or the patient is moving too much, or restlessness, sedation is not enough, or unclear extubation plan. And also clinical complications and other complications, respiratory and cardiovascular complication, including cardiac arrest, and other complications increase the length of the stay in the ICU, in the hospital, and increase the hospital cost as well. So they put some plan about the optimal intracheal tube securement device, and they keep all the staff aware about this device. It is variable from hospital to hospital, but anyway, the unplanned or accidental extubation is an important issue as well, especially in ICU, and we should have some plan for re-intubation. Now, this patient actually happened with me 30 years ago when I was just 7 or 8 years experience in anesthesia. It is 63 years old, obese, hypertension, old inferior MI, and right bundle branchial block, and he came for lumbar discectomy. And for me, it was a little bit difficult to intubate, so the patient was intubated by my senior during this time. After that, we put the patient in the prone position, and the chest and the pelvis roll is not a good position, so they tried to for repositioning. During this time, it is accidental extubation because one of untrained nurse tried to help us to put the chest and the pelvis roll, but unfortunately, accidental extubations. Okay, so everybody's asking now, where are you? You should secure that you. Actually, this 30 years ago, we are using this manly ventilator. I know the old generation will understand me. This black rubber tube was short. When they trying to change the position, I'm trying to move the ventilator more close to the patients, but unfortunately, this is a patient has extubated. Of course, we put him in supine position again, and I am more fortunate that I can intubate it without the help of my senior because he already left after the intubation. Anyway, this happened more 30 years ago, and I can't forget it. And alhamdulillah, it never happened with me again. So the risk of accidental extubation can occur in patient gastroscopy, ENT surgery, dental surgery, cranial surgery, maxillofacial surgery. So the surgery is very close to the head, very close to the tube, and you have limited access, and the tube can be moved and removed easily. This another patient happened also with me, but this few years ago, 24 years old female. It was healthy, no medical problem. And she came for maxillofacial surgery, bilateral sagittal split osteotomy and genioplasty. And it was submental intubation. I know it is not common, but at some stage, the maxillofacial surgeons prefer the submental intubation. After intubation, they produce some opening in submental area. Then you disconnect the connection and move the tube under the tongue. Anyway, It was during this a surgical problem. During this section, maybe 3 or 4 hours after start of surgery, this is very long surgery, may take 5 or 6 hours. This leak, and I not able to ventilate the patients. And you can see here the surgeons cut the tube during this section, sublingual dissection. Anyway, you have to remove this tube and to reintubate in bloody field, unstable maxilla, unstable mandible. But again, I am lucky, alhamdulillah, to remove and to reintubate these patients. Okay, come now to the guidelines by DAS for the tracheal extubations, and they focus in 4 points. Proper airway management need right practitioner, right equipment, right preparation, and right location. For preparation, you have to prepare your team, prepare your patient, and prepare your equipment. So this is the safe management of airway. And before extubation, everybody is aware about this criteria. You have to stabilize the vital signs. You be sure from the respiratory parameters. You should be sure from the CNS, the guide, the patient is awake, alert, and the follow command, and can sustain the eye opening in children. Return of all the protective reflex, gag, swallowing, and the cough. And very important as well, the reversal of the neuromuscular blockers, strain of 4 more than 90, or strong hand grip, or head lift more than 5. So all these 5 items, vital signs, respiratory, cardiovascular reflexes, and reversal of neuromuscular blockers, all baseline criteria before removing the tube from the patients. The guidelines focus in 2 major issues which can occur during extubation, the laryngeal spasm and the post-obstructive pulmonary edema or negative pressure pulmonary edema, and we will discuss it in some details. So we start with the laryngeal spasm, which is a protective reflex, and it is exaggerated reflex causing the closure of the glottis. And it occurs in the light plan of the anaesthesia, and it is mainly a vagal reflex, so through the superior laryngeal nerve. And they found the incidence 9 to 1,000 in adults, 17.5 to 1,000 in children, 28 in infants. But if the patient has upper respiratory tract infection or bronchial asthma, it is 96 per 1,000. That's why all the patients with active upper respiratory tract infection should be postponed maybe up to 3 weeks until normal reflexes. The reflexes is impaired up for 3 weeks. So what is the risk of the stridor or laryngeal spasm? Of course, light anesthesia, you have a lot of secretions or blood or depress on the vocal cords. Traumatic intubation may cause upper airway edema, high cough pressure, subglottic edema. Silent aspiration may be a sign of stridor. So if you didn't find the other factors, you should think why this patient has a stridor. You may think at passive aspiration if the patient at risk for aspiration. Prolonged ventilation in ICU and the female patients. Laryngeal spasm is more common in pediatric patients, and it is still responsible about the significant morbidity and the mortality. This about perioperative cardiac arrest in pediatric patients. They found that the laryngeal spasm causing a major problem regarding morbidity and mortality. And the incidence occurred 12.2% of all causes of cardiac arrest. You may have cardiovascular causes, respiratory causes, or metabolic causes, but laryngeal spasm, about 12% cause of cardiac arrest. One of the, maybe a few years back, it is a major controversy and the discussion. What do you think? Coughed intracheal tube may cause post-operative stridor and spasm in pediatric patient or no? I can hear some persons tell yes and some persons no. So what do you think? Here, in they have a major study of around 1,000 patients in each group, either cuffed or uncuffed, all right? And they found that post-extubation stridor is 4.4 in the cuffed tube, 4.7 in uncuffed tube, a little bit high in uncuffed tube. But in this situation, they can found that Secondary tube changes occurs in 1% of all cuffs. So maybe more manipulation of the airway during intubation and re-intubation cause a little bit higher incidence of the stridors. Also, you can found that the capnograph is not so reliable in the uncuffed because a lot of leak around the tube. So the reliable capnography is not good in uncuffed tube. So again, the questions to use cuffed or uncuffed. There is no longer feasible role for the use of the uncuffed tube in pediatric patients. All the patients should have cuffed tube unless if you have some special clinical circumstances, you have to avoid the tube for any reason. Maybe severe subglottic stenosis or congenital anomalies or, but all the patients should have cuffed endotracheal tube. Okay, so we finished from this point. How to prevent the laryngeal spasm? One of the very common practice, maybe everybody is doing it every day. We have two studies. One done by Professor Anis Paraka. I think all the persons in Middle East aware about Anis Paraka. And it was more than 38 years ago. And another one 7 or 8 years ago about the IV lignocaine to prevent the laryngeal spasm and the stridors. It is very simple studies, just in tonsillectomy, giving betadine, atropine, fluorobarbitone, halocaine using during this time with intracheal tube, but in this all type of surgery, but they use the laryngeal mask, not intracheal tube. And the more sophisticated monitoring, even BIS, I don't know who has used the BIS in this pediatric patient, but this is the design of the study. Anyways, important for us, the outcome or conclusion. It is the same conclusion by Anis Paraka 38 years ago, 2 mg/kg, 1 minute before extubation is effective. Again, 2 mg is effective, but it is short-lived and incomplete. So intravenous lignocaine, 2 mg/kg, 1 minute before extubation, minimizes the risk of laryngeal spasm. According to the DAS guidelines, if you have stridor or spasm, you call for help. You will apply CPAP with 100% oxygen. Everybody's doing that to do Larsen maneuvers, and you may need to give some propofol to keep the patient more deep anesthesia, and this will help to relieve the stridor. But if it is more severe and causing significant drop in the oxygen saturation, you need to give propofol, you may need to give succinylcholine. If no IV line, you can give it IM, but atropine if indicated, and re-intubation in severe cases, you can re-intubate your patients. You may ask why Larsen's maneuvers may be used. As I mentioned, laryngeal spasm stridors is a vagal reflex. The pressure on the base of the skull or by this Larsen's maneuvers causing significant sympathetic stimulation. So it may counter the vagal reflex by the stridor. That's why we are using Larsen's maneuver or laryngeal spasm notch to relieve the stridor. Very, very, very interested test or maybe articles by my colleagues in Saudi Arabia, Rojdi, Hani, and Salah. They did gentle chest compression, this mild chest compression over the sternum to relieve the spasm. What they found that the patient successful to be treated by chest compression is 73%, while 38% if you apply CPAP. And actually, since they introduced this maneuver, I am using it if the patient using the stridor or laryngeal spasm after extubation. And is very, very effective. Maybe they mentioned here 73%. It is almost more than 90% in my pediatric patients. So what I am doing in pediatric patient to prevent spasm? Of course, you have to start with induction, give lignocaine before intubations, the optimal position and the deep GA, even if you start inhalational and you get the IV line and the patient is under deep inhalational anesthesia, it is better to give fentanyl, propofol, and the muscle relaxant before the intubation. This give you optimal position and the airway management or trauma will be very minimal. And to select the proper size in the cuffed intracheal tube and of course the proper cuff pressure. At the end of surgery, this very quiet recovery, don't let the nurses to touch the patient during recovery, putting some dressing, putting the bumpers, change the position, doing the removing the thermal plate. Anyway, no touch during the recovery and emergence. And you can give another dose of lignocaine and no suction, only if you have or you are sure there is some secretions or blood you want to suck it, especially in upper airway surgery. If you need to do suction, still at Mach 1, deep anaesthesia, and before the reversal of muscle relaxant. So at this time, you can suck even under vision. You can put the laryngoscope and do that. But blind suction in light anaesthesia, 100% you will have some problem. And then you will do the artificial cuff technique. I will explain it now. And you have to balance between deep or awake extubation. If strider of care, again, we will come back to the guidelines. Larson's maneuver, gentle chest compression. You will apply CPAP. You may need to give propofol or succinylcholine, atropine PRN. For the patient who have striders, I prefer to give racemic immobilizer in the recovery room, because most of the patient may have some degree of the glottic edema. It is well known that the epinephrine causes some vasoconstriction, so it will reduce the glottic edema and it will reduce the stridor and the reincidence of the stridor. So what is the artificial cuff technique? It is effective expiratory flow which clears the secretions and to push it away from the glottic. How to do it? Deflate the cuff and let the tube connected to the breathing system. Don't disconnect the tube at the moment. And put the expiratory valve at 40 or 50 centimeter water and squeeze the breathing tube during withdrawal, the tube from the trachea during extubation. This means you will keep high flow of oxygen during extubation. It is more or less close to the recruitment maneuver, but it is not a recruitment maneuver. You need to produce high pressure inside the tongue. So after extubation, this high flow or high pressure, high oxygen, high air inside the lung will come out after extubation, and this will push the secretions away from the vocal cords. Laryngospasm may occur during induction, okay? And during inhalational induction, you don't have IV access. So you can inject the succinylcholine IM 4 to 5 milligram, and atropine also can be given IM to avoid any problem. Okay, so this is the management of the laryngeal spasm. Now we will come to the negative pressure pulmonary edema or post-obstructive pulmonary edema. And of course, everybody is aware about that. It is closed, the patient trying to take deep inspiration against closed upper airway. So it will create a high negative intrathoracic pressures, and this will increase the venous return and cause negative pressure pulmonary edema. And it occurs within few minutes. And fortunately, it can resolve within few hours, but of course it needs some management. So this is the mechanism. We have our airway obstruction, either spasm or maybe foreign body, and inspiration against obstructions, high intrathoracic negative pressures, high venous return, high capillary pulmonary pressures, and this will cause disruption of the alveolar membrane junctions. So movement of the fluid from the interstitial fluids and inside the alveoli, and at the end you have pulmonary edema. Even after relief of the obstruction, pulmonary edema will persist. And you can see here, increases the venous pressure and the congestion of the capillaries, disruption of the membrane and flow of the fluids, low protein edema fluids. So how to manage? Of course, you should try to relieve the airway obstruction. Like laryngeal spasm, you should apply CPAP 100%. Put the patient upright position. If it is mild hypoxemia, just put the patient on non-invasive ventilation. But if it is significant, you should reintubate and apply BEEP. And you may need to give opioids for dyspnea. Diuretic is questionable because this patient is not overloaded. But if there is pulmonary edema, it is almost routine clinical practice to give diuretics in patients with pulmonary edema. and you may do chest X-ray to exclude other pulmonary problems. So this is the management of the post-obstructive pulmonary edema. Now we are coming for the extubation, and you have many plans. Deep versus awake extubation. Extubation with LMA. That the patient is already intubated under deep anesthesia. Remove the intracheal tube and apply the laryngeal mask and let the patient to awake slowly. And extubation, re-intubation over fiber optic bronchoscope, especially if the patient needed fiber optic intubation, gallbladder bogies or airway exchange catheter. And of course, the patient at risk, you should assess him well. At risk for difficult to maintain the airway or difficult to maintain the oxygenation, or the patient at risk of aspiration. So we have this logarithm for many steps. You have to plan, to prepare, to perform, and post-extubation care. For planning, to assess the airway and general risk factors, and sure, this should be done preoperative. And you have to see, maybe something may happen during the surgery, trauma, bleeding, or edema, or the patient have some interoperative problem, and also cardiovascular, respiratory, metabolic status, mental status, and surgical procedures. You have to assess all these risk factors. If something you can correct it, and you can optimize the patient, you can optimize him, and you should consider your skills, the skills of your team, and proper monitoring and proper equipment. According to this plan and prepare, we have two groups of patients, low risk for extubation and high risk for extubation. Low risk, the patient can maintain the airway, no risk for aspiration. So you will follow the low risk algorithm. If it is risk for extubation, you will follow the high risk algorithm. After that, the patient may go to the recovery or ICU or high dependency unit according to the patient's situation. And of course, you have safe transfer of the patient and handover for the other medical team, physician and nurses. And to be sure, the equipment in the where you are going to recovery or ICU, they have almost the same equipment you used during the surgery for intubation. And of course, full monitoring during transfer, proper analgesia, and documentation. Now we have two logarithms. We will start with the low risk logarithm. You already do the plan, you already prepared the patients, and we have patient. You can do deep extubation or awake extubation. Before extubation in general, this is the general precautions, 100% oxygen suction, you put airway, reversal of the neuromuscular procars, the patient breathing is normal, minimize the head and the knee movement because this will stimulate the airway, deflate, apply positive pressure. Apply positive pressure, this is equal to the artificial cuff technique that I explained now, and ensure adequate breathing. After that, either you select a deep extubation or awake extubation, again, the patient is going to recovery room or ICU, and the same precaution, safety, monitoring, and oxygen supply. If it is difficult for extubation, again, you may have to reassess. If the patient can be extubated, it should be awake, not deep. No patient with difficult airway should be extubated with deep anesthesia. It should be awake extubation. And you can extubate, as I mentioned, you can replace the intracheal tube by laryngeal mask. You may put small dose, low dose remifentanil or dexmedetomidine infusion, and you may extubate over airway exchange catheter. If it is highly risk, postpone extubation. If the patient has severe upper airway edema, for example, or bleeding, wait for 1 or 2 days until control this situation. If extremely difficult, you may consider tracheostomy. Again, safe transfer, safe monitoring, and documentation. So we have two algorithms, high risk and low risk, and you have to follow. Now we have important question. Should we give 100% oxygen before extubation? What do you think? I think most of you told 100% is okay. Actually, according to the lung protective strategy recommendation, which published last year, not last year, in 2019, during recovery or emergence, if you are using oxygen more than 80%, it is increase the incidence of atelectasis. And of course, it will mean increase the post-operative pulmonary complications. And if it is clinically okay, use 40% or less during recovery. So during the end of anesthesia, you are off SIVO, this fluorine, isoflurane, or whatever. Don't put the oxygen on 100% unless if you have specific indication. Keep it on 40 or 50% to reduce the atelectasis. And after extubation, you can give oxygen to maintain, to maintain the saturation more than 90-40%. So 100% oxygen is not essential in most of the patient with normal bleeding, with normal lung, and the patient not at risk for hypoxia. Can we do deep extubation? What is the hazard? The hazard if the patient is obese or low oxygen saturation before extubation. This increases the risk. So don't consider this patient for awake extubation. Of course, it should not be done in patient with difficult airway or at risk of aspiration. And you should good experience to do these maneuvers. And deep extubation is not a standard anesthetic technique. If you are query and you are not sure what is going to happen, and wait until the patient is awake and extubate him. The last point in my lecture is the airway exchange catheter. This, as you can see, has 15 ml connections. Long catheter can be removed and connected again, and can be access for the airway. You can put it inside the intracheal tube, and you can connect the oxygen to the this connection, and you can connect the capnography as well. And you can leave it in position inside the trachea for a few hours. It is can be used for reintubation guide or suction, and it is radio-opaque as well. To put the airway exchange catheter, you may need some sedation. You may need to give glycopyrrolate to reduce the secretion. Of course, this patient is indicated for airway exchange catheter. He needs 100% oxygen. And to know the, exactly the length of the intracheal tube, then insert the catheter according to the length you measured, extubate, and check the position by capnography, even if you need to do chest X-ray, and you can lift it in for several hours until you are sure everything is okay, you can remove after that. This is one of the, my patients, 16 years old, juvenile rheumatoid arthritis, and has fixed flexion deformity of the neck. And he has esophageal fibrosis and stenosis, and he came many times for esophageal dilatation, and it was intubated many times by nasal fiber optic intubation. But because the manipulation of the airway by myself, by sometimes we need the ENT to help us, and also by the gastroscope may cause significant glottic edema. So I put the airway exchange catheter before the extubation, and I leave him in dexmedetomidine sedations, and it is left for 4 hours. And you can see here the exchange catheter in the right nose. He has nasogastric tube in the left side, don't forget it. But he has this airway exchange catheter on the right nostril, and we left it 4 hours. We are sure he is very awake, normal breathing, then we removed it after that. So how, regarding the airway management, we have a lot of error. So to error during the management, it is human, but to repeat the same error is negligence. To teach from your error, this is your experience. To learn your experience to the other, this is the success. So we have another big question: how to avoid the complications with airway, or somebody may, you did already trauma, you did accidental extubation like myself, or you did any problem. So it is very simple. Just do nothing, say no such nothing, and you will be nothing. You should do your job, and you may expect some complications, expect some problems, but you should teach from your experience. So in conclusion, the right practitioner, right equipment, right preparations, and right locations, and extubation should always, in elective process, give you a time. So now this is the last thing I will, you know, more funny. Why I selected, it is hard to do. You can listen to this song. Waking up is hard to do.
Cause waking up is hard to do. I lay her down, down, down. One more try. Down. I'm only 9 months too young to die. Down. I put all my faith down. In you. Cause waking up is hard to do. They say that waking up is hard to do. Now I know that it's true. Don't say that this is the end. Instead of waking up, I think my vision's opened up again. I am in such misery. Feels like my eyes are taped and I can't see. If I wake, I'm going to soon. Cause waking up is hard to do. They say that waking up is hard to do. Now I know that it's true. Don't say that this is the end. Instead of waking up, I think my vision's opened up again. Now I'm awake.
I love you, honey.
Now I got to be.
I think you should...
So there was one question about the cuff leak test. What do you think about the cuff leak test? Is it accurate enough, and should we do it before extubating a patient for which we are afraid of edema or airway obstruction?
As I mentioned regarding the suction, especially, most of the anesthesiologists to me do it blindly and do it in light plan of anesthesia. So if you are sure your patient needs suction, do it under deep anesthesia, maybe max still 0.8 or 1, and before reversal of muscle relaxant if the patient receives muscle relaxant. And in many textbooks, they recommend suction under direct vision by laryngoscopy. Don't do it blind in pediatric patients, especially because any minimal trauma may cause airway injury. Most of my case, if I'm sure the patient is needing suction, I am not doing the suction. Actually, when I'm doing this artificial, most of the secretions come out spontaneously with the high pressure coming from the lung, so I don't need suction too much.
Okay, but do you do a cuff leak test that you deflate the cuff and see if there's a leak, enough leak that can reassure you about extubation? Is it accurate enough? What do you think of this test, the cuff leak test?
Just the cuff deflated, yeah, and when you're applying around 40 or 50 pressure, 50 centimeter pressure, at least will be inside the tongue is 30. Not all the way the air will be leak around the tube. So at least you have 30 or 35 centimeter pressure inside the lung. So when you remove the tube, it will be effective respiratory flow.
Okay, thank you. Another very rapid question about dexamethasone. Would you give dexamethasone? Before extubating when you are afraid of edema and obstruction?
Yeah. If it has happened early, the airway trauma early during the intubation, you may consider it. But we are aware enough to know the effect of dexamethasone. More effective will take 6 to 8 hours. So it is effective in ICU. To be effective in anesthesia, it is not clear actually. But most of us, as a routine work, if the patient has airway trauma, we give it. If dexamethasone is so effective after a few hours or no, I am not sure. That's why I am using racemic epi at the end.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Yasser. I think it was a very nice seminar and excellent presentation. Do you agree on Dr. Mahdi? Do you agree on finishing this session and closing this session?